I can't quit now, Luigi. I was born with a plunger in my hand.
I know. I was awfully hard on Mom.
48 minutes of dogs barking. 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 Growl. Growl. 48 minutes of dogs barking. 48 minutes of dogs barking.
So you know the fucking internet version that leaked all those Pentagon papers or the you heard about the name of the Discord server he was on, right?
Thug Shaker Central.
Amazing.
Was that? Yeah.
So I wanted to start off with this because I feel like you would really appreciate. So I was listening to Intercepted, which is a podcast presented by or produced by Intercept. The host is Jeremy Scahill. I didn't listen for a long time because they had people that weren't him hosting.
Yeah.
It felt like forever. And then like I kind of like Jeremy.
I like Jeremy. Yeah. Gym.
So I started listening again. Like, oh, he's back. I like his approach to things.
Right.
So I'm going to play something from the most recent episode. The Discord leaker, Jeremy Scahill, says something that kind of blew my fucking mind. And I'm going to put the phone up to the mic here.
You know, and also Joe Biden and Mike Pence, you know, also are known to have mishandled classified documents and taken them to their private residences. And, you know, Biden seems likely that it's part of the kind of general I'm above the law, egotistical posture that many, many, many Washingtonian insiders have taken over the decades, where they just feel like the laws don't apply to them and they can take documents home. I mean, it's possible there's something nefarious there involving Hunter Biden and China and Ukraine and the big guy and all that stuff. I mean, maybe that's true. But the facts as we understand them, it seems like Joe Biden probably did what scores of Washington insiders do, and they just feel like it doesn't apply to me. I can take these home to use at my think tank or whatever. With Trump, though, it does seem a little bit like there is a parallel here. It's like Mar-a-Lago is Trump's Thug Shaker Central. Like,
oh, my God. You're doing the Thug Shaker?
Turn around. I saw Joe Biden's Thug Shaker. Not very nice.
Turn around and shake that shit. Yeah.
I'm like making breakfast listening to this. And I'm just like, you know, I'm like fucking frying an egg and shit. And I'm just like, what the fuck?
Yeah. Just like, absolutely.
Fucking, like, am I losing my goddamn mind? And I'm like, no. And I went back and I'm like, okay, it's like at the 15-minute mark. And
right.
I was like, I got to remember this.
Right.
Even if it means leading off the episode.
No, that's great. I love it.
Yeah. amazing. Just hearing someone who's like he's got a sense of humor, but a very straight laced journalist. Like,
yeah, very dry too.
Yeah. I feel like, you know, it was mentioned on Chapo. It was on a couple other podcasts I've listened to. And I'm like wondering, do any of them understand that there's a meme called the Thug Shaker?
I don't think they do. I don't. I
do they know about the prototype money
and the jet oil you can win? Yeah, I don't know. I don't know that they actually do. They're just like, oh, it's okay, Thug Shaker, whatever. Yeah. Boy, that's weird. Anyway, you know, they just kind of gloss over it. Yeah, it's been a really strange day on the internet. Today is 4/20, of course.
Yes. Are you smoking the devil's lettuce?
I am not today because I said, you know what, I'm gonna have a beer, and mixing the two is just a recipe for disaster.
It's usually
so
not the vibe.
Yeah, no.
No,
no,
it's
especially not for this show.
Like driving here. I don't know. I'm really glad that we's legalized.
Right.
And all the things that come along with it. But like, oh my God, the fucking amateur hour. I feel like you're off that fucking the honeycomb 2.5 milligram, you know.
Right.
Edible.
And they've eaten a whole one. Yeah.
Half of one. I just get sleepy.
Right.
You know.
They're not doing 100 mils and all that. Yeah.
Jeez. Oh, no. There's that one brand that does like the 30 milligram edible.
Oh, God.
Just for people that if you like, if you put your head up, your ear up to like their nostril, you can hear the ocean.
Yeah.
Like,
sure.
It's just,
they've been at it a while.
Yeah. Just, I mean, like, if I took one of those You could perform surgery on me.
Yeah.
Like, just like, I'd be like, sure, whatever. I'll need that.
What's that?
I'll hold that.
Oh, is that my kidney? All right.
Yeah, because like the whole entire time driving down here, like, I'm just like, I just want to be like, bitch, be cool.
Right, right.
Everyone's doing weird stops. Fucking, I cut through the park. All these white people are walking their little ass dogs.
Hey, by the way, just because we keep forgetting to do this, it's 48 minutes of dogs barking. My name's Jason. Alongside for the ride with me is Brian, my co-host with the co-most, wearing a t-shirt, by the way, that says problematic, and I love it.
Thanks.
Pretty much fits the vibe.
Yeah.
we're just rolling along today. Yeah, I don't know. Oh, speaking of white people, I gotta give it up to our a listener of the program, a close friend of the pod there, Matt Basler, host of the Matt F. Basler podcast. He did reach out to me in support of our latest episode about stuff white people like.
Oh.
And his message was very great. I asked him, you know, can I read this? And he goes, yeah, sure. Because he just messaged me out of the blue, all caps, here's my problem with the things white people like blog. And I'm going, okay, this is good. Starting off strong.
Mr. Producer! Yeah. These are the things I hate that the honkies are doing!
He says, most of it is only, quote, white people stuff if you don't know anyone other than white people. Like eating McDonald's. Oh my gosh, me, Kevin, Ryan, and Mary eat McDonald's. Dennis loves it. Ha ha, that is so white. And then again, in all caps, black people eat there too. You just don't know any. And then I said, I said, oh yeah, can I use this? He goes, yeah, that's why I'm a meme. It's especially bad when it's good things like classical music or working with computers or things like that. Yeah, no way a Mexican would do those.
I've never seen a Mexican use a computer. I don't even know. Listen, I don't even know if they have jokes down there.
That's right. You did say that. It's just one of those weird things where you go, this isn't right. I don't like this. And you can't figure out why. Because, like, I don't want to shit on kitschy, lame humor all the time. Whatever. Some people like it. But you can feel that this is that plus worse. And so, yeah, we've...
So I gotta ask you something.
Yeah.
There was I've seen this go around Twitter a couple times, you know, over the last like 5 or 6 years, where someone in black Twitter will be like, you know, talking about things that are like, you know, only black families know about this, and like,
right.
And like some of them are like, okay, yeah, I could see that. Like if you went to an HBCU and all that, or you know, a lot of things like, okay, yeah, I could see that. But there was like always like a couple things like certain like food things.
Yeah.
And like also the one that always kills me is growing up thinking that it's illegal to have the dome light on in your car.
I thought it was.
It's not.
See? It's not just. Oh, wow.
And like I never want to be like the fucking white guy that says like, well, white people are afraid of doing that too. But like I think like, oh, some of these things are more class based or regional based.
Oh, they're definitely class based. You definitely know like the struggle is real.
If you're afraid to have the dome light, I am terrified to even turn an interior light on in my car. Yeah. I'm afraid that like some cop is just going to fucking double tap me and plant like a fucking drop gun on me.
Jesus. But yeah, that is a very real fear. I know that I have it. I've instilled it into my children, so I don't know.
Arrive alive, don't turn on your dome light.
That's true. Sad but true. A little bit of local news, Brian. Have you seen this story?
The evil homo eagle,
Murphy.
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 Has adopted an eaglet.
Yes.
And is grooming it. This is terrible. Where's Josh Hallway pass?
Well, the story actually goes, Murphy, you know, his instincts kicked in, and he found a rock that looked like an egg, and he was protecting it. And people were kind of like dunking on this bird, like, ah, oh, he's such a stupid bird.
Dumbass bird.
And then, but then the bird sanctuary in question, again, here in Missouri, they found an eaglet whose nest had been destroyed. And so they introduced the eaglet to Murphy, and Murphy, the bald eagle there, Murphy stepped up. And, you know, somebody, Patrick Moynihan from a podcast that I really like called What a Time to Be Alive.
Yeah.
Patty Moe, he photoshopped Murphy into a t-shirt. I'm not the stepdad, I'm the dad that stepped up.
Yeah, great.
The classic. So yeah, really, it's a heartwarming story. Yeah, I like a good story.
I believe I've met Murphy before a few times.
Yeah?
In Bird Sanctuary. I mean, he can't like fly or anything.
Right.
He can't really do a lot. So he
right.
The bald eagle, the symbol of our country, is like a bird that doesn't just kind of chilling.
Which
like
is not
it's this really great thing, but it's just I don't know, it's just a really big bird.
Yeah, he's a big man. I liked the idea that Benjamin Franklin was gonna, you know, say the turkey should be the national bird, and I think that's an even more useless bird. So
oh, the walking bird.
Yeah, exactly. So
I don't know, I think the turkey is a more projective of I mean, the bald eagle looks fierce, but
yeah,
it's a scavenger, which is no disrespect to how it you know, it makes its paper and all that.
Mm.
The turkey, I think, is a more interesting looking animal.
Oh, for sure. Just plumage wise.
Yeah.
But speaking of America, our president, Joseph Robinette Biden, was over in Ireland, the mother country, this past week. He was telling an anecdote about his cousin, Rob Kearney, and his particular role at Soldiers Field in Chicago when the Irish rugby team beat All Black. But in typical Joe Biden fashion, he said, "We beat the hell out of the black and tans."
Come on, shake black and tans, come on and fight me like a man. Show your wife how you won medals down in Flanders. Tell her how the IRA made you run like hell away from the green and lovely lanes of Pilichandra.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Fucking Irish Joe is the best Joe.
Irish Joe, he cannot be defeated.
No, it's so good.
I'm going to drop that right here. He's you know me. I'm one of those guys who's like, I've never been, but I'm, you know, fiercely
you
Irish.
You want to go to the motherland?
Oh, I'm going.
Oh, okay.
It's just I haven't been yet. Yeah. I went to England in 99, but I haven't been back to Europe in since.
That was kind of the peak of British culture.
Well, that was... what's interesting is that when I went was the weekend that Tony Blair was signing the Good Friday Accord, so it wasn't too bad a time to be there. Wish I could have been in Ireland instead, but, you know.
Sure.
I got as close as I could at the time, you know, at 18. But yeah, Irish Joe. I love Irish Joe. He's my favorite. More Americana hitting the feed from Lauren Boebert. Hey, Bud Light. We talked about Bud Light last week in their Dylan Mulvaney can. Well, hey, Bud Light. Here's the one America wanted, she posted. And it is a photo of Pat Tillman.
Yeah. Before we riff on the Pat Tillman thing, you know what's a fact I found out in the last week that really fucking blows my mind about the whole thing with the trans influencer?
Okay.
They only made her one can.
Yeah, it was just one can.
Just one can.
Yeah.
One can.
One can.
One can.
One can.
And we're fucking single fathers are blowing their brains away after family court. Like,
and then Julie Melner at Using Cigarettes replies with Chris Dorner. Yeah, there's
nothing. I would absolutely positively buy a Chris Dorner sixer. Show up to the fucking float trip
with the Chris Dorner
fucking cans. Tie that shit to my fucking kayak. Fucking just burning cigs all day.
What you want to do about it? Yeah. American Hero. Yeah.
Yeah. Can't corner the Dorner.
Oh, that was the thing, wasn't it?
During
his flee from justice. Our good friend of the program, Merritt Kay, found a site where an AI tries to explain memes.
Who up playing with a worm?
That's one of my favorite. Who up playing with a worm, okay? We all know that worms are slimy, wriggly, and just plain icky, but that didn't stop one intrepid young boy from playing with them. He was excited to find them while digging in the garden and quickly scooped them into a bucket. His mother was less than thrilled, but the boy was fascinated by these creatures. Now, of course, you and I know who up playing with a worm. It's about jacking off, but...
Yeah.
But the AI apparently thinks that's not what it's about.
Amazing. Beautiful.
Hey, yeah.
Yeah, and everyone's like, oh, AI is going to replace everything. And it's right. Like, it can't even understand what like a meme is.
Right.
Like, I'm training an AI on Goatsy. Just Goatsy.
Just to identify pictures and go, no ring, no ring.
No ring. Oh, Jesus, the hot dog, not hot dog.
Where was I going with this? Oh, it is, I guess it's time for Crypto Scam of the Week, Brian.
Let's knock this shit out.
You're listening to 48 Minutes of Dogs Barking, the podcast.
And now it's time for the Crypto Scam of the Week.
All right, well, Crypto Scam of the Week this week, I got a twofer today because I couldn't decide which was funnier. One of which is an NFT collector getting scammed, and the other is a pump and dump from Nicole Benham. So we're going to start. NFT collector Franklin claims to have been scammed for 2,000 ETH, roughly $4.2 million. Now, Franklin is bored is the actual handle that Franklin goes by. Big collector of Bored Apes. You know, he's... I think at a certain point in time, he held like 50.
Oh, yeah. He was probably a guy that got in early.
So on April 13th, he sold a good chunk of his collection. Why was that? Well, on Twitter, Franklin said, quote, due to an unfortunate IRL issue, I have had to sell off a lot of BAYC apes to pay off Ben Dow loans while the liquidity was available. So 27 of his 50 apes were sold. He later wrote, I got rug pulled on an investment I put almost 2,000 ETH into, thinking it was credible due to who else was invested. He did not name them for privacy reasons. Someone used our money as a casino gambling Ponzi and flushed it down the drain. Please learn any lessons possible from this. Of course, people started to speculate about what it was that he invested in. No one was really able to really get a good idea, but it's assumed that he was trying to cover up losses from Rollbit, which is a crypto casino. Apparently, he had 6,000 ETH in losses from that crypto casino he was trying to cover. He did say, for partial transparency, my personal profit and loss from my Rollbit gambles is about negative 650 ETH total. So, yes, I lost a lot of money myself in Rollbit, but that didn't require me to sell off today. Again, 650 ETH is a million and some change.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's no small money. So yes, Franklin Isbord did say, take a break. The quote.
Yeah, I would take stock of my life.
Yeah. The quote, I won't get involved in NFT trading Twitter for a while and will just focus on my private life for the time being with my remaining apes. It's the
I'm like, I just feel like if I were in that situation and somehow got fucking
rolled,
hornswoggled
yeah.
out of $14.2 million in
$4.2 million
still. In assets, I would probably be like that scene in Frey Got Fingered where Tom Green is like talking to the animation executive and he pulls a gun out of his briefcase and he's like, "Should I blow my brains out?" And he's just like huffing on the barreled gun, like you see his cheeks moving in and out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can see that.
I would be doing that in a bathtub.
Right.
Alone.
Yeah. Just so that
all my apes are gone.
So it's just easier to clean up, I guess. Is that what you're saying? Yeah.
Yeah, because the people that have to come clean it up just have to like basically take the bathtub out.
Right. Yeah, I've heard some of those. Like a guy I know used to work for ServPro, so yeah, he would tell those stories and be like, "Well, you know, thankfully they did it in the tiled bathrooms." We had to.
Yeah, you just gotta clean the grout really good, take the bathtub out. Like,
right.
You know, it's not like some selfish motherfuckers that like shoot themselves in the head in like a hallway and then crush through the door.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Anyway, I feel like that took a really dark turn. Sorry.
I don't know. I honestly feel like if you're going to take your own life, be considerate who has to clean up your bullshit. You know, if you really wanted to be certain.
Okay.
I would blow my brains out while walking in front of a train.
Okay. So if one doesn't get you, the other one will.
whoever witnesses it, be like, dude, I just saw the craziest shit.
Right. They got stories for years.
Oh, uh-huh. Yeah. Like, oh, yeah. So your dog digs something cute?
Yeah.
I watched, yeah. I watched a dude in board shorts blow his fucking brains out in front of an Amtrak. Like a smooth motion.
Just one step, two step, bang, splat. Like, yeah. Just real bad. Yeah.
Yeah. The birds were everywhere.
So, focusing on your private life for the time being with my remaining apes is a great phrase. It's another MK Ultra activation phrase that I think is going to be rattling around some brains for the time to come. But
amazing.
So we go from Franklin to someone who did a pump and dump. This from Web3IsGoingGreat.com, by the way. Big fan of that site. Always keeping us up to date with this stuff. the author there writing, new passive voice Hall of Fame contender just dropped. Quote, yeah, there were mistakes made in a wallet that I controlled. Continuing on, writer, journalist, and now Web3 influencer Nicole Benham helped pump Dogecoin founder Billy Marcus's now free-to-mint Blocky Doge 3 NFT project. First of all, what a fucking sentence.
Yeah.
writing on Twitter, quote, wrote, no roadmap for utility I'm in eyeball emoji, and talking it up in large Twitter spaces. A wallet belonging to her then received 250 NFTs from Marcus, dumped 220 on the market all at once, tanking the market price and earning her around 20 ETH or thereabouts, $38,000. At the moment, the NFTs are selling for an average of 0.031 ETH apiece or about $59. Now, that's not the end of it. Okay. Nicole then wrote on Twitter, there were mistakes made in a wallet that I controlled, but claimed that she tried to make it up by returning the profits and buying up low-priced NFTs. Again, a quote from Nicole, how the last 24 hours went down was not cool, and I'm doing my best to rectify the situation. Listening, learning, moving forward. Listen, it's the live, laugh, love of crypto. Listening, learning, moving forward. Shortly afterwards, of course, she was removed from a NFT 100 list that had published only days prior by NFT Now for what they described as a violation of their ethics policy. Wow. It's a lot of audacity to get a bunch of free NFTs, flip them immediately, and just be like, oh, there were errors. There was a mistake made.
I mean, but that's a classic move that there are a lot of influencers in the crypto space.
Oh, yeah.
They'll get like an airdrop.
Sure.
And then they'll be in their private channel on Telegram or Discord or their public channel.
Right.
And be like, oh, I've got Peppy AIDS. Oh, wow. What a fun little meme coin. Let's see if we can get this to 1 milli.
Yeah.
And, you know, and then someone's like, oh, yeah, I found a wallet that looks like it's theirs. And they were airdropped what then was like, you know, $1,000 worth, which then became $10,000 worth, and they dumped it.
Right.
There's a lot of crypto influencers who do that sort of shit and get away with it. It seems like a really easy job if you have no morals. It's just to have like,
yeah,
you know, be like, wow, I'm never getting vaccinated anyways.
yeah.
Have you guys checked out Doge Prolapse?
Yeah. Pure blood coin. Yeah. Whatever it is. Yeah.
You know, wow. I'm really glad that there's no soy food here in Turkmenistan where I had to flee.
Yeah. From the SEC. Yeah. Oh boy. Yeah.
Wow, I'm living the alpha lifestyle.
In a Bulgarian prison. Yeah. You never know. these people. But yeah, the Twitter thread from Nicole Benham is worth a read, by the way. It's any remaining profits from the sales from that wallet yesterday will be sent to Royalty Wallet. Bullshit. Prove it. Yeah, right. And of course, Dando Crypto, Dan.eth, just replies with the clown emoji, because of course. And then, look, it's page after page of clown. yeah. And then Georgia Sinclair, of course, not the most trusted person to respond to this, saying all these comments are from people who have done the same and would do the same. And she's not wrong in that, because given half a chance, half the people replying would absolutely pump
it up. Of course.
Yeah. Who wouldn't? It's free money.
Free money. It's free real estate.
yeah, exactly. Even the images. You've seen this? This blocky doge?
It looks like a sex offender. Yeah. With some Twizzlers in its hands. Mr. Simpson, what are you doing?
sweet can. Yeah. I don't know. I don't know what that's even supposed to be, because it's like it's a red, a green, and a blue.
So it's I'm guessing they're supposed to be like candles from like a chart.
Okay. Yeah. That's even dumber. Yeah.
It's pretty stupid.
Just terrible. So yeah, between Franklin and Nicole, boy, what a weird week to be a crypto person, because boy, yeah. Either you're getting scammed or you're scamming and then just being like, well, there were problems. I don't know what happened.
I forgot to send it to you, but I was like scrolling Twitter one evening and some guys I follow were talking about like this account that had bought like a good amount of Ethereum back in like 2014 or 2015 when it was still new. So they put like 10 or 20 grand into it and it became a ridiculous amount of money over time.
Right.
And no activity on this wallet from like really like the first purchase.
Oh no.
And then immediately gets drained by like what looks to be like a fucking like tech support fucking scam.
Oh.
And so it was like someone just immediately lost like $30 million. Has not touched the fucking wallet since the initial purchase. It just immediately got.
That's insane. Oh, is this the one Tavano posted?
Maybe.
Yeah, 9.88 million. Was that how much? It was like 5,000 ETH.
It was a pretty significant amount of money. Yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah, for the past 48 hours, I've been unwinding a massive wallet drain operation. I don't know how big it is, but since December 2020, it's drained 5,000 ETH and however many tokens across 11 chains. Oh, wow. No, this is completely different. This is something going...
Oh, this is insane.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's...
It's not a lowbrow phishing or a random scammer. It has not wrecked a single noob. It only wrecks OGs. Please be safe. No, wow. No one has determined the source of compromise. This is 3 days ago. My best guess is that someone got them a fatty cache of data from a year plus ago and is methodically draining the keys as they parse them from the treasure trove. The theft and post-theft on-chain movement is very distinct. If you've been drained by this attacker, you will gasp as you read this. Primary theft transactions are... Oh God, they have a time frame. Jesus wept. Secondary thefts occurs 4 p.m. Yeah, they're like, we have a specific time frame. We have a, you know... Wow. We'll keep an eye on that. We'll get a full report.
Yeah, that was not what I was talking about, but holy shit.
Yeah, no shit. Wow. So yeah, it's time to talk about our main topic this week, Brian.
Oh yeah, we got to talk about some load-bearing drywall.
Load-bearing drywall, that's right. You may have heard that phrase going around online. Of course, our good friend of the program, Jay Brentsteder, may be the authority on this, but I'm going to take a crack at it, as it is one of the most enthralling sagas in all of Something Awful history, at least in my mind, as someone who has been working on a house for 10-plus years. That is, of course, known as Grover House. Grover House. Grover House refers to the construction of a home addition. So it was not the home itself, but was an add-on. It was going to be a garage. It was going to be a bunch of different stuff by Something Awful forums user Grover.
I thought he was a mod.
Okay, yeah. According to theaggie.org, he was a moderator at the time in 2006 when this thread was posted. So yes, we have confirmation there. So the idea was to build, in Grover's own words, a new kitchen, two-car garage, workshop area, three bedrooms, a bathroom, and a living room. Grover himself, an electrical engineer by trade, had opted, instead of calling a buddy, instead of doing anything sensible, had decided instead to do it all on his own. With the notable exception, by the way, of the concrete and the siding. Two of the things I feel like I could do. I mean,
I feel like, you know what, I could probably do the concrete.
Sure. You got to start from the beginning, because it bears repeating that this was built in an area that is really shitty to build in, okay?
Yeah. I think it's a holler.
Oh, it is the Great Dismal Swamp. It is the Great Dismal Swamp, Brian.
Amazing. That doesn't sound encouraging for any home improvement endeavors.
No.
Yeah, I'm over in the Dismal Swamp. Yeah, I'm just trying to get up the code, you know?
Oh, not just any Dismal Swamp. The Great Dismal Swamp. Yeah.
I'm
It's a degree of difference from that and the Dismal Swamp. Yeah, the just, oh, Jesus. He was a mod for, you know, he'd been a user about 4 years, and then he decided he's going to detail this home improvement project.
Yeah.
It's ambitious. I've already listed you. That's a lot of work. It's a lot of stuff to do. And, you know, you got to factor in, you know, how much stuff there is. I mean, there's, God, I was looking at the actual list, and it's like, oh, yeah, his.
The original Photoshop.
Yeah, that was his MS Paint drawing where he was adding on to it, and it looks awful. courtesy, by the way, the Aggie.org, Jacob Anderson wrote a really great piece on this back in 2021.
Imagine having a house so shitty that someone has like written like well-researched articles
yes.
on it.
Oh, yes. When anonymous users post photos of the lumpy asymmetric house from within Microsoft Flight Simulator. Yes.
Yes.
Grover House is in Microsoft Flight Simulator.
I remember like that was like the first thing people did is they found it and then they drove their planes into it.
Yes, the double doors set strangely high without attendant steps. These learned users engage in a sort of silent worship for the house. It is a symbol, an avatar of sorts, for the months of heckling glee that once rang out on the Something Awful forums, and according to some, will never come again. So yes, new kitchen, 2-car garage, workshop area, 3 bedrooms, bathroom, and a living room. He had done a number of weird things, like insulating the stairs, putting insulation in behind the risers. There's no need for that. You don't need to do that. It's stairs. What the fuck are you doing? He'd insulated the stairs. He built 2 garages right next to each other instead of doing a 2-car garage. So instead of doing what you would think to do, which would be to build double the size.
He instead
took 1 garage and just said, yeah, we're going to copy this over here, which included like cutting into beams that were going to be supporting the roof because the beams would go into it. It's insanely stupid. yes, and the phrase load-bearing drywall does come up. But yes, here is a photo here. This is Grover. This is the house before Grover. This is at boldlybuilding2 on Twitter has taken to that thread, pulled out the necessary images, because even with forums archives, the thread
is kind of wonky.
It's very wonky. If you want to look it up yourself and you have archives and you're a Something Awful user, look for the thread, how we built a huge addition onto our house, doing it all DIY, 56K no. Which, of course, meant that if you were on a 56K modem, this was a bad thread for you because there were a lot of huge images.
Well, you had to see all the handiwork.
Correct. And fairly modest. You'd see that in fluorescent. That'd be like an A-frame home.
Yeah, I mean, this is like a...
It's average. It's got a decent
A-frame, yeah.
Yeah, it's got a decent driveway. There's a fence. There's some kid stuff in the backyard. Here was his Microsoft Paint edition. And again, it just looks... It's hard to convey this over a podcast, but I will tell you that it looks like shit.
It looks like dog shit. No... It looks like the thing you make in The Sims so you can kill people in a room with just a barbecue pit. Like, you don't really care. You just need to fill all the empty tiles with gravestones and have a haunted house.
Right. You're just kind of, like, cloning shit at random. And, like, yeah. But, yeah, it says, Grover looked upon a swamp and dug one of his many shovels into the mud and began his greatest work. And here, the Great Dismal Swamp abutting right back to the back of your house. So here, here is the muddy, disgusting backyard once they started digging. They did lay a foundation eventually, so thankfully that did get properly done. In construction?
Those stairs, I feel like there needs to be some support in the middle of that second stretch from the landing.
There's got to be something, because there just whoever framed this...
This isn't the city museum. This isn't whimsy.
Well, even the city museum reinforces their shit. I mean, yeah. They got guys over there with, like, welding shit, fucking... putting up metal, make sure everything's all square. Like, they don't fuck around there, by the way.
I've had friends that worked at the city museum. It's very to the fucking T. There's I don't know when I'll ever bring this up, but there's a guy in the St. Louis hardcore scene that's an infamous blowhard. He's an obnoxious human being and Mr. Fucking Tough Guy.
You don't say.
And he has like he has a fucking Crass tattoo. Looks like the Cowboys from Hell logo from a distance, which is amazing.
What a combo!
But his
yeah.
job his job used to be run the fucking trains on the second level. And so, you know, he'd be Mr. Fucking Tough Guy and like hardcore bands that he was like trying to impress all yeah. of a sudden would find out like, oh, you do the choo-choos? It was this real fucking Ian McKay ice cream eating motherfucker yeah. kind of thing.
Wasn't, I mean, George Carlin was Mr. Conductor on Thomas the Tank, for so, I mean, it doesn't matter.
Sure.
Watching the construction of this thing in slow motion via photos is just like, it's like watching a nightmare. Like every time you see a new photo, and these are all in chronological order. So this appears to be a haphazard collection of timbers and boards that they're just kind of, because I mean, this here, that's plywood. That's what you should use, but mm-hmm. you need to cover it, right? It started to tower over the main house. It's obviously a big addition. They're yeah. doing all this stuff in there. He picked up just random shit from hardware stores, and you can yeah. see it in some of these photos. Here's a double, here's some French doors for a certain section. Okay. This weird rounded window that apparently was just like, it was a good deal. So I just picked it up. Like, we'll figure it out later. Listener, he did not figure it out later. I'm actually kind of. You see here where he had an opening for a square window, but then decided that he was going to add in the rest of it. So the grand plan of this house is in this diagram here. Yet another Tron-looking fucking image.
Is this XCOM?
Yeah. Grover has a 90% chance to not get a crit.
The grazer in the grazer in the Grover house.
Someone did, by the way, a few years later, make a Grover House Doom wad. I remember so that. If you ever want to go back.
I think there might have been a CSGO map or something like that. I can't remember.
That's right. Yeah, Counter-Strike had a custom map for Grover House as well. But yeah, this part is the part that always confused me. I can sort of understand what he's trying to do, but the way this is laid out, and again, this is me doing my best for, you know, audio.
This looks like something from the Sega Genesis game Poltergeist.
Yeah. From remember? Like Shadowrun. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, jeez.
It's got the isometric view and everything. So the idea was, and I can kind of see what he's going for. Here would be the front door, right? And it's this, it's kind of offset off the street. Mm-hmm. And then, but the thing that always baffled me was that they had a garage, which again, could have just been a two-car garage, but for whatever reason, Grover decided that he wanted one side of the garage to be just the size of one of the cars, and then the other side of the garage to be a different size for a different vehicle. There's no reason to do that. That makes no fucking sense, and it added all this bullshit. So they've got this staggered garage thing, right? And the garage itself leading into the kitchen, which, okay, that happens. People do that. This bit...
No mud room.
No.
When you live in the great... Dismal swamp. Yeah, you don't have a mudroom?
Yeah, you would think there would be some, you know, something. I guess this here at the front door would be where that would be, because it looks like that was what was planned.
Yeah.
But then there's these weird, there's alcoves everywhere. There's random bedrooms that don't appear to actually be necessary. There's one with, like, nothing. It's just a bedroom. No closet, just a bedroom. Just odd stuff, odd choices. Part of it, too, is that, you know, he's in the Great Dismal Swamp. He's got a septic system. So a lot of the plumbing stuff that he wanted to do wasn't going to work. There was a huge part about, like, zoning regulations. He couldn't get shit zoned right. And, like, yeah, from the first post, the land back here is swampland, flooded half the year, and should never have been built on. we were very much looking forward to being able to reliably flush toilets a full 12 months out of the year, and even when it's raining. Oh, my God.
What a nightmare.
It just seems like he dug his own grave, quite literally, in a lot of cases. Yeah. But just
what part of the country is this?
The Great Dismal Swamp.
For anyone that wants to go hunting for Grover House.
Yeah. The Great Dismal Swamp is in Suffolk, Virginia.
Oh, God, your nuts are getting immediately attached to the fucking pant leg.
In between Norfolk and Elizabeth City. So yeah, you've got a
that sounds balmy.
Oh, it does. Where to go? Here's Google saying where to go in the Great Dismal Swamp, by the way.
Check out Scenic Grover House.
Come see something awful legend.
Come see history come to life.
at Grover House.
You know what? I would do that. I would go on a Grover House tour.
I would go to Grover House and just bully the like children in the street. Why do you live next to Grover House? Seems kind of gay. Oh, the backside of that house is just—it hurts. Like six different types of windows.
Yes, the French doors, which I mentioned earlier, which again it was clearly like some deal that they got. There was that weird rounded window, right? And you've got the window upstairs with. Have you ever seen this? I don't know. This is not a thing that I'm aware of. But a regular 8-pane window, mm-hmm. and then with 2 4-panes on either side of it, making it a total of 16. But like. Why? It felt like they just kind of like were, oh, we have this much space. Let's just put a few more windows in.
Yeah.
For no fucking reason. Some of the other stuff that kept cropping up. Here's the bill lasted well into Christmas. So here is a photo of the half completed staircase.
I think I posted this on Facebook. Like, yeah. Merry Christmas, everyone. Yeah.
So all the stockings hung on, like I said, a half completed staircase.
That staircase looks so sketch.
Real sad. And it's right. So it's going down.
I think I remember someone making a comment of what happens if you trip going down the stairs.
You're going out the window.
You just comically fly out the window.
Yes. Woo! Yeah. And boy, when you ask Grover how much he spent on it, I think they said they raised $27,000 in hopes that their bank would match them so that they would have $54,000 to finish the project. Now, like I mentioned, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of stuff.
A lot of work.
$54,000 for that? Buddy, you got another thing coming. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, but like, Jesus Christ.
He could have maybe done a one floor extension.
You didn't need the two stories. But yeah, the stairs leading out, because the way the stairs are.
It's so bad.
It's the stairs are leading, and then there's a window that's like right at kid height. So if a kid were to fall down these stairs, they're going out that window.
Yeah, no, they're fucking getting yeed.
And right there, there's like a heated return. Like, it just, they're trying to dig, right? The water table is 6 feet below the surface. Okay. So you got to imagine it's clay. It's all clay. It's a swamp. They had sump pumps and all. I mean, just trying to keep shit dry. Yeah, they fucked up the foundation plans. They had to figure it out. This is an expansion of an existing house, right? So Grover, an electrical engineer, attempted to tie in his electrical for the expansion to the main house. Rather than trying to tie straight in, they figured, well, we'll put in a second wall.
Oh, I forgot about this.
Uh-huh. This will allow for settling. This is in Grover's words. This will allow for the settling in addition to hopefully be even. I ended up undercutting my foundation and pouring a new footer about a foot deeper than the old footer, which the masons blocked up with a 1-inch gap. Wasn't enough. The existing wall bowed in 1.5 inches, which ended up messing with my new walls too, which sucked. Frowny face. You can't tell on the finished house, but it was readily apparent when hanging the kitchen cabinets. And it still bothers me that my wall isn't perfectly plumb. The two walls are nailed together at several places. Most notably, I nailed the ceiling, again, in the old kitchen to the header I put on the new wall when I broke the new opening between the two. I placed a 2x6 above the existing joist in the attic, 16D nails through the new tripod header, and onto hurricane straps to support the... Then, so essentially, the ceiling is now suspended. He wrote suspected, but suspended by hurricane straps from a board nailed through sheeting into the other wall. I hope there isn't much settling between these walls. Sweet Jesus. That is, by the way, the where the origin of the phrase load-bearing drywall comes from.
I forgot about the part where the roof is basically just like, it's just like a cross of your fingers. Like,
nailed it in. Put some straps up there, fucking.
We'll figure it out. Hey, I'm Bill Clinton. Your house is fucked.
Yeah, well.
I don't know why I like, my voice got a little green, you know, a little vocal fry.
Here's my favorite part. This is, because I feel like this part could happen to me. When construction on the Grover House was finally finished, Grover and the family pulled out the grill for a celebratory dinner. However, Grover failed to move the grill far enough from his recently laid siding and melted it!
Yes, because I remember there's photos in the back of the house where there's like a chunk and you can see like the... Yeah.
Here it is. You can see the underlay because he had to pull the melted siding off.
See, as someone that used to work for a place that sold grills,
yeah,
have to tell people, hey, you want so much clearance from the dwelling.
Right.
Any kind of walls or anything like that is a fire hazard.
Yeah. If you don't live in a brick home, don't put your grill up against the side of the house. That's part of the deal.
And even then, you don't want
to
do that.
No, not up next to, obviously.
Yeah, you're gonna get soot on shit. And,
fair.
Yeah.
So, he had a huge problem with air, getting air conditioning.
God, this looks like a bondage video.
So, what Brian's referring to is, in an attempt to make sure all the air conditioning ducts were going as they should, it wound up being like taped over here and doing this. So that it does kind of have that look of the Reapers from Mass Effect, where they're just kind of like fingers up through the ceiling.
Mister says I can't talk to anyone until I cool the house.
And, it really is just like, what the fuck? Here's another wonderful picture. Here's the second floor, ridiculous television. One serious speaker, to paraphrase Space Ghost, and a really shitty looking recliner. This is on the second floor, obviously. Up in the ceiling, apparently, Grover had put an obscene amount of lights, the dual garage system. They put a window unit in the upstairs, even after running all that HVAC. They still had to have a window unit because it wasn't working, Brian.
Amazing.
Any person who has done any kind of work on their home will know it's a pain in the ass. Shit gets fucked up. But this guy, because he thought he knew everything, he managed to fuck up in ways that I didn't think were possible. I didn't think that you could bone up this bad. But apparently, Grover is not immune to that sort of thing. Yeah, just... Yeah.
And you know, there's been great memes about Grover House, but I still think my favorite is the Al-Qaeda hideout diagram.
I have that one, yeah. Here's the Al-Qaeda. So that was a thing, what was it, Time Magazine did it?
Time Magazine, right after 9/11, did like this thing about like the hideout.
Right.
Of
And there it is. Yeah, so someone did a mock-up of Grover House with the graphic from Time Magazine of a Mujahideen fighter overlooking, in Time Magazine, it was, of course, Osama bin Laden's hideout.
Osama bin Laden's hideout, and you're like, how they have like all the training, the underground training facilities and
right.
shit. And...
Yeah. Instead, it's a Mujahideen fighter overlooking garbage disposal, what does it say, drywall, load bearing. just absolutely. If you really want to go on a tear, actually, she's been banned for a long while. At 3 Liza, that was...
I forgot she got banned.
Yeah, she got the ban hammer a while back. But she had quite possibly the best thread of
Grover House
images. So. The backup would be our friend here at Boldly Building 2. That's Kyle Cost Billions on Twitter there. He does have an enormous amount of resources from that thread, including the System Shock 2 looking layout for the HVAC.
It's so painful.
To go through every single fuck up in Grover House would take us the rest of the hour, Brian. Because there's just
the rest of the evening.
Right. I mean, here's the circular window getting installed.
I actually think the circular window above the staircase like that is like...
It's not, fine.
It's not a there's worse choices you can make.
It's fine.
Get some natural light coming in. Like
you frost
way.
It. It looks, yeah. You know, it looks fine.
Yeah.
But hanging the
kitchen.
Yeah.
I have not seen too many photos of the kitchen, but the few I have seen have been really painful.
Well, because he got what I got, which is these ready-to-assemble cabinets.
Yeah.
Which are always a dicey proposition. If you haven't measured within a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of an inch, these ready-to-assemble cabinets will fuck your life up. I experienced that twice in the kitchen that I that I fixed. But we had to return them. He, Grover, stalwartly did not. And so there were numerous things where they had already cut holes for outlets in the wall. They just kind of went, well, that's no longer an outlet, I guess, because the cabinet's going over it.
I feel like Grover would be one of those guys that would really fuck up putting in like a pot faucet.
The man could fuck up a one-man parade, according, you know, like,
yeah.
Just
anyways, we had to demolish half the house because I fucked up putting in the fucking pot spigot.
Looking at his backsplash is like, okay, all right, why did you do this? But yeah, Kyle here posting a fairly typical photo of Grover House. I cannot stress enough just how cluttered every shot of Grover House is. It was like nothing was kept clear while they worked, and it bothers me to my core. Here's the kitchen in real life, incomplete, and with so many outlets, over the counters, over the cabinets, everywhere. The upper deck, again, 15 lights for no reason. Four, count them, four air returns for the AC units, which did not work. Again, the garage with the staggered doors. Still don't understand it.
Looking very much, yes, that looks like a swamp in that photo.
Well, this part right here, I mean, here's the piping being laid behind the house. Again, here's your output. Supposedly, sump pumps were running like 24/7. It's still a swamp. It's a swamp. You're building on a swamp.
You're building on a swamp.
Building on a swamp, Jerry. But yeah.
He's building on a swamp.
Every surface, everything that I see of this house screams, this is wrong. Yeah. Nothing's plumb. There's no cohesion to any of it. It feels like a fever dream of someone trying to assemble a house in SketchUp with like a third grade education.
Yeah.
They don't know what this guy's an electrical engineer. This is a guy who's supposed to kind of sort of know stuff.
Yeah.
Grover House, ladies and gentlemen.
Grover House. God, I'm going to go home and download Flight Simulator and crash a Boeing 747.
Oh, man. I can't understand.
It's like one of those things that would be like a McMansion hell, except...
Yeah, except it was... This guy built it himself, and he went like triple over budget. Because originally, remember, he had budgeted $54,000. I think he wound up being like 200 grand in the hole by the end of it.
Yeah. Amazing. It looks like dog shit.
Yeah. I mean, here it is, again, a boldly building two. The bathroom of Grover House. With these three images, you get the full experience of having to run to the toilet after accidentally eating dog food that you mistook for Cheez-Its and drinking paint you thought was milk in a sleepy haze because the kitchen counters are so cluttered.
This looks terrifying.
Yeah.
And it's like the fucking, that shower stall is like the shower stall you have like in a science lab.
Or a college apartment.
Yeah, it looks like where you fucking pour out your fucking mop water at like your shitty mall job.
Yeah. He wound up buying two Roombas. I mean, just the story of Grover House will not fit within a single episode. So if you want to go look at the pictures yourself and get secondhand Schadenfreude, by all means, as I said, at Boldly Building 2, the Twitter account that has a majority of these photos rescued from the archives and lovingly displayed.
Oh, gosh, what the psychic damage.
It really is. There's nothing like it. There's nothing like Grover House because it's this weird combination of like, I know everything guy, right? And this real fierce DIY shit. And he thinks he can do it. And God damn it, nothing's going to stop him. Even common sense, which should have told him to stop $27,000 ago. And he keeps going.
So my last job.
Yeah.
I was on the trucks doing deliveries once. And we were out Frontenac, which is a very...
Shishi area. Yeah, it's very rich.
Bougie. Yeah. A lot of old money there. A lot of new money buying shitty houses that kind of look like Grover House, like,
but intentional.
But like a nice version of Grover House, and they're always like $800K. And they're
of course,
You know, that same house would be like 120 in like Florissant or Hazelwood in North County. You know, I'm with the driver, I mean, like this old surly guy, He's one of those guys. Like, it's funny because he just hates the job. And then anything yeah. outside the job, he's just, like, really pleasant. It's just, like, on the clock. He's like, man, fuck this.
Yeah. And, well, I mean, who doesn't do that?
Well, right he had to take this job because he was a foreman at, like, a plastics factory. And the factory got shut down. And so he went from making, like, $80,000 a year to making considerably less.
Yeah.
And so I can understand his surly nature. But we were doing this delivery. And I'm like, pull up to this house. I'm like, this house is beautiful. What the fuck? It's usually because it's all these shit that would be on McMansion Hell.
Yeah.
Going through like this really beautiful brick wraparound stepway that goes to the back patio on, you know, the basement floor, you know, and the owner comes out and he's a real friendly dude. And there's this house isn't like a normal house. It's got a story, right?
Right.
And he's
right.
It's like, oh yeah. This was built for the original owner of the St. Louis Blues.
Okay.
And I'm like, oh, so we're talking about the house, and he like takes me like after we done with the job, and the driver's like settling up with stuff and like taking photos of the patio furniture we dropped off, and he's like, you know, oh, you know, these pieces were taken from a church in Europe, and I'm like, well, that was like the style of the time. Like, if you're a rich ass motherfucker,
yeah,
you like bought a church, took it piece by piece, and then you rebuilt it in like Philadelphia, yeah, and being yeah. like, look at the money I got. I rebuilt a fucking church for no reason.
Hey, yeah.
Or a monastery, whatever. And he's like, you know, show me the black opal mirrors in the the basement bathroom, and like, you know, the kitchen, which had not really been touched since like the 50s. You know, it had like a fucking charcoal rotisserie.
Ooh.
It was fucking wild.
Yeah.
You know, showing me like, what the owners called the Asian room, and this is where they used to watch tape back in the day. And,
sure.
You know, what is the garage now? It used to be like the movie theater. And
oh,
like,
yeah.
Show me all this cool shit. And I'm like, man, this is really cool. And he's like, I think he was just amazed that a guy that was delivering his furniture, like, knew something about architecture
and could appreciate it. Yeah.
Appreciate it. He's like, you know, he's like, well, in the carpet on the family room in the basement was fucking done. And, you know, he's like, well, I got to figure out how I'm going to do this right. You know, and these curtains aren't mid-century. You know, mid-century doesn't really have curtains like these. And I'm like, yeah, you know, I think you just, I mean, when you're looking at mid-century modern, you're just looking at natural light. And the fucking driver is looking at me like,
come on, man. He's checking his watch.
Like, yeah. And, like, you know, and he gave us, like, a tip. And, you know, we had to go back to the shop to pick up some other stuff because his stuff filled up so much of the truck. And I was like, yeah, no, he's with his cool house. I bought the house. It was the original owner was the first guy who owned the Blues.
Sid Salomon Jr., by the way.
Sid Salomon Jr., yes. And yeah, he was telling all stories about Sid, because there's like this private drive that goes off the street. He's like, that's where he would go to avoid like the press in the morning. He made like a deal with the property owner behind him, and like all this cool little stories.
Yeah.
And the driver is like, I was like, hey, show me all this cool stuff. And my coworker, he goes, yeah, you should tell him about the part where you sucked his dick. And I go, hey, I told you not to tell anyone about that.
It was
and
confidential.
He like spun on his heel. He didn't expect me to come back with like, hey, that was between.
Yeah.
That was Scout's Honor.
It's private.
Yeah. And he thought I was going to get pissed off. Don't say I was sucking someone's dick.
Right.
I just said was... don't tell anyone I was sucking someone's dick.
Right. And it's a big difference, yeah.
Big difference.
That's a hell of a story, man. I don't think I've ever heard that one. That's good.
Yeah, no, it was cool. Yeah. Now, a lot of times it was just like, you know, dealing with rich people that like
yeah.
would do things like put NPR on really loud while we were like installing their barbecue grill. Then they'd be like, I still think you're an asshole. And it'd be like, right. You know, you go out to these places where, you know, like a different driver I was with would be like, yeah, you know, like a lot of hockey, like St. Louis Blues players
sure.
live in this neighborhood and stuff like that. I'm like, oh, that's cool. He's like, yeah, I've seen such and such and waved at them, and like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
And then like, you know, they got like deer grazing in the backyard and shit. But then, like, you know, these houses are so fucking big. If you want to talk about, like, a misuse of space, like,
oh,
there's
yeah.
just, like, an entire room across from the kitchen that's bigger than the bedroom in my apartment.
Right.
And there's some fucking token artwork on the walls, and there's just a big fucking oak table with a flower bouquet centerpiece. And it's like, so you gave up on this room.
Yeah. There's no, you don't use this for anything.
Yeah, and yeah. like so many houses we would go into were like, you know, like, oh, this is lived in.
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah.
then there's houses we would leave, like, we would leave and we'd be, like, muttering under our breath, like, the fucking grandkids hate coming here.
Oh, yeah. I bet. It's so weird. But real estate, especially in this area, it's so fucked. Like, there's people like me and people like my neighbors who are just, like, we're going to scrape every little bit of space we can out of whatever we got, you know, because I got, like, 1,600 square feet, which is pretty big.
Yeah.
But my neighbor to the left, they're like 2,300 square feet.
Yeah.
And this is a person who, like, doesn't have kids and, like, they live with their partner and their dog. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's not a lot of used space.
Yeah. I mean, it depends on how you use it. Obviously, I could probably fill up 2,300 square feet if I want.
Sure.
To, but, like, not the average person.
No. I mean, most people. I mean, most people that I know, like, 1,600 is plenty. You know what I mean? Like, that's a lot of space. And those places you're talking about in Frontenac, I mean, that's...
This was the...
6,000.
I mean, I'm also, like, talking about places, like, out in, like, West County, Town Country, places like that. Like, I just remember being in one where we had to fix a lady's... the fucking logs on her electric fireplace or the well, not electric, but like it's like an electric start and you run the gas line
yeah,
and all that and you get the fucking, you know, you fucking fuck around with copper wire like your goddamn fucking chimney sweep.
Yeah.
And I remember like standing in this lady's kitchen. It's a very expensive house and it smelled like dog piss because they had a little fucking rug rat running around. and I just remember the fucking guy I was with being like, gosh, you know, if you're going to have a dog that pisses everywhere, you know, I wouldn't get fucking white carpet.
Oh,
like,
shit, yeah.
Yeah, so there's, like, fucking, like, oh, like we were actually leaving and saw, like, dog piss and, like, paw prints across the white carpet.
Yeah.
And, like, fucking disgusting. But, like,
insane.
I'm, like, standing in this lady's kitchen, and there's a detached, like, rumpus room.
Sure.
And there's, like, a pool and all that because, of course, you gotta have a fucking pool. And I'm, like, sitting there, I'm realizing, like, I'm, like, talking to the guy doing the fireplace stuff. I'm just being his second set of hands. I'm like, we're, like, in, like, the kind of, like, family room attached to this kitchen here. Yet, where I'm standing, I see one kitchen, and there's another kitchen probably no more than 30 feet apart from each other.
Yep.
And it's like, who fucking thought this through?
Nobody. That's nobody.
I guess when you have money, you can just be fucking stupid.
Yeah.
I feel like we're doing the, that fucking clip someone once sent me of the old Candyman with one of his buddies looking at the like the Zillow listing for Hassan Piker's house. You know, and you can tell that, like, you know, he's all like, yeah, no, that is a really stupid, like, backdrop to put by your grill area. And you, I imagine he's just looking for all the entrances and exits.
Yep. A little weird.
I'm coming for you.
That's right. Yeah. Oh, Jesus. All right, well,
I kill you. still
legally,
one of the funniest in real life.
That's right.
Still one of the funniest fucking, maybe one of the funniest things Sam High has done, next to like the gangster guy coming back to his dad's house.
Oh Jesus!
And his fucking shitty brother is like playing Resident Evil 4 in the living room. Gosh, Sam High, what a terrible person, but the highlights are so
high. Comedy, yeah, it's one of those things where you have to kind of like, well, terrible person, but damn, this is funny.
Yeah. just the fucking shit he did to that one other fucking internet weirdo with the fake girlfriend.
The fake, and he did an entire fake interview. He had all of his crew pretend to be... That's a whole other thing for all
the iDubbbz.
Yeah, it was iDubbbz. That's right. Yeah, because he had his entire crew just like faking for this entire week. It was like a weekend. It was a full weekend. He had him out for like 2-3 days.
And they finally like let go. Like I think the last day or two.
Yeah,
the iDubbbz was there, but like, it's a really amazing piece to watch. I watched both of those documentaries.
Back to back.
I really still don't know what to think other than like. What is friendship is really kind of the thing because even like in Sam Hyde's documentary where he's like joking about fucking with iDubbbz and iDubbbz people, it's like almost like in a way he's trying to get his approval
in a way. Yeah.
It's like really like Sam Hyde can't stop. He wants to commit to the bit, but he also wants like this guy, I think, to like him a little bit.
And that's the delicate balance, isn't it?
Yeah. Fucking with someone, but also like, hey, you think I'm cool, right? Like, you like the, I'm driving 8 miles per hour on a congested highway in the beat the shit IROC.
I've always liked an IROC, but that was because I grew up in a neighborhood where a guy was constantly repairing one every weekend day.
Oh yeah, I had that, but it was a Corvette.
Okay.
There was a guy in my neighborhood. He had a white 70s Corvette.
Mm-hmm.
And he was always working on that one. And then in his garage, and the garage door was always open.
Right.
So you could see what I guess was the project Corvette.
Oh, no.
And then at one point he had three Corvettes. Jesus. And they were like all, and like, and they were all like white, like early 70s. Like one, maybe he was parting them out. Like he maybe. Was like yeah. just trying to get one working. I never saw him drive it.
Really?
Yeah.
Because the guy who worked on the IROC, he at least would take it up and down the block. You know, and you, muffler would be fucked up.
Ratios
and
he, are fucked.
Yeah, and, but he also was a guy who collected pace cars. Do you know NASCAR how they do that? They have a
I knew a guy in my neighborhood growing up in Spanish Lake like that.
So yeah, they have these cars that they keep the pace for the first lap, and then that car goes off the track. Well, this guy went around and bought up pace cars. Anytime he would go to a race, and he would just like buy the. I don't know what he did for a living. He lived in a bigger house than I did, and he had, you know, an IROC that he was working on every weekend. He had a pace.
Kids?
Two shit. Kids.
What the fuck?
I don't know. He must have been
like working McDowell Douglas or some shit.
Maybe.
Fucking wiring stuff.
Just weird. Okay, I think it's time.
And now, the moment you've all been waiting for. Shock.jpg.
I want to avoid this video as much as I can, but I can't anymore.
As long as it's not the McChicken.
It is not the McChicken.
Did you see that photo of the McChicken that was going around the internet?
No. What
there's
is
this,
this?
There's this... Oh, God. Someone posted on Twitter that like the this McChicken absolutely cum blasted with mayonnaise.
Oh, God.
There it is.
Ew. Okay. Yeah, this...
read the description.
Enjoying a McChicken on this wonderful day.
I don't know if that was the original.
This looks
post.
To be a double. This looks to be like there's double chicken in there.
Yeah, it's fucked up. I think the original post was like feeling safe in America or something like that.
Yowza. Yeah, looking for McChicken on Twitter is a dicey proposition to begin with. But
yeah, there's a lot of interesting photos there. Okay, so what's this shock thing we got here?
So the shock thing we got today, Brian, is a repeat offender. We have another visit from our good friend Alexei Tatarov.
Oh,
you remember Mr. Alexei Tatarov?
Mr. Jar,
also known as One Guy One Jar, also known as Jar Squatter. E fucked brings us this one. Called One Guy, One Screwdriver. That's right. Alexei, not content to just have a jar up his ass, now has a screwdriver inserted into his urethra. Once he gets the jar a good way into his rectum, he then pulls the screwdriver, which was inserted handle first, by the way.
That's an important detail.
And there comes the blood. Yes, it is distressing. To the extreme.
Wow, it's...
Yeah, it's gushing.
Oh. This is good. This is way better than poop and pee. He's doing the same thing like he did.
Oh.
Oh, like he did with the jar where he's just like, you're like, oh, I'll fix it by just ineffectively touching it.
And then he's going to stop the recording. Yeah, so... And then he shows you the aftermath. A pool of blood and a screwdriver. Oh, yeah, Alexei, I really hope your dick still works, buddy, because that looks really awful. And, of course, he brings you to his bathroom.
Oh, it looks like a watermelon was washed out in there.
Yeah.
The man watermelon. Oh, of course, the E-fucked.
I know. They have to bring the E-fucked watermark, but yeah.
For quality.
So...
When media filter's not hardcore enough.
Correct. You'll never guess what the background music was. Hold on. You'll never guess what the background music was, Brian.
Yakety Sax.
Circumnabulation of the Transcendent Pillars of Singularity by Barzoom. That's right.
God, these fucking perverts need to be stopped. Being horny was a mistake.
I'm enjoying the Mujahideen. I'm going to ride horses through the countryside in Afghanistan and marry a chaste woman where we'll grow poppies so we can kill Americans.
Nothing has distressed me more on the shock.jpg segment than that video. Nothing. 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 Drinking piss? Okay.
The going human smoothie?
Human the vomit smoothie? Fine. I can sit through that. But the guy pulling the screwdriver handle first from his urethra.
It's not the way you think you'd do it.
No, you would think you would go blade first.
Because then you'd have the handle.
Boom. Yeah, you got a handle to go. No, he has to pull the Phillips head to get the handle out.
Oh, man. And it's like trying.
It's all the way in there, too.
It's in there. He's into the hilt. Oh, man.
Again,
you think your
nothing
wife would
ever... on this segment has made me feel more ill than that.
Do you think your wife would help you with that?
I would hope my wife would take me to the fucking hospital or that at least numb me first.
At least you're open to it.
Sounding was never my thing. Putting things in there, it's not my deal. I'm open to a lot of stuff, but that's not one of them. I'm not going to go... First, also, I'm not going to go handle first.
No.
I'm not going to start with that.
That seems, I would go not handle first.
Why don't we start small? A cocktail stirrer, perhaps. Or something glass where it's easy to, I don't know.
Tempered glass.
Please. Yeah.
Seems like a bad idea.
Seems like a very bad idea. Another bad idea, which is, of course, the full-size pickle jar going up your ass to begin with.
Oh, and he flops that. He gets in there.
Well, this ain't his first time. We know Alexei. We've seen him break one in there, so we know it's not the first time.
But it's just like almost comical how easily that one gets into his ass.
Because that's the easy part for him. It's the screwdriver.
For me, it would be a journey of a lifetime. But for him, it's just another day.
It's a Tuesday
at the shock office.
Oh, and I've told you this, that he's on TikTok now.
Yeah.
Alexei's on TikTok and as that jar guy, which I still think of all the handles he could have chosen, yeah, lean into it, I guess.
It's amazing.
I can't get over it. I'm seeing the blood gushing out of his penis in my mind. I can't erase it.
Grow up.
Brian, let's try to do our best to erase this image by going to the breath mint segment of the show.
Okay.
I think that's probably the most responsible thing to do, I guess.
Yeah, so I guess I'll start. So I went to Off-Broadway to watch a man pull a screwdriver out of his
face. You think Steve would have that on? You think he would do that?
God, Steve... God, you think, you know, maybe the low lights would work out for that.
So you don't have to look at it too closely.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord.
Jeez, poor Steve.
I know.
Me and my girlfriend went out Thursday night to see Bass Drum of Death.
Oh, yes.
The Wild Boys from Mississippi. I hadn't seen them live in almost 10 years. I think the last time I photographed them was 2014 at the Firebird.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was really wild to take a look at those photos. I haven't really kept up with them too much. Like, the new record came out in January, Say I Won't.
Mm-hmm.
And my first response was like, there's a couple of bangers on here, but it's not my thing. And then I kind of grew on me. And I'm like, oh, yeah, you know, there's a lot to like about this record. It's got something a little bit more polished, but it still feels like the first two Bass Drum of Death records, which I think are... pretty fucking tight.
Now, I did read amusicphotographer.com, by the way, and your write-up of that did mention that it was one of the guys from the Black Keys.
The drummer.
Okay.
The guy that abused his ex-wife,
yeah.
Allegedly. Yeah.
But
he didn't abuse the musicians he was recording. Oh!
But he did produce the record, and so it's got a bit of a...
It's the first thing he's produced that didn't make me want to forget what music sounded like.
All right.
I don't think he's a... very good producer, but on this record, I think he did a adequate job. I feel like whatever, like, seasoned engineer at the recording studio they went to probably could have done better.
Sure.
But you know what? Some guy named Gary,
with a balding ponytail. Even though he's still got cherry ears, like it doesn't have the same patch as like the guy that his band exists to sell you, you know, Dodge Caravans through Sinks. But the show was good. And the thing is, I didn't realize that John, the main guy, that motherfucker grew. He got tall.
Oh,
he like, I'm like, this motherfucker was like a, like was, you know, like 5'11".
Yeah.
And I'm like, this motherfucker's taller than me now. And I distinctly, the last time I talked to him, remember being like, this guy's kind of short.
You sure he wasn't just like hunching?
No. I mean, but you know, maybe he had a late growth spurt. Cause he, I mean, I, the last time I had like seen him, he was drinking a beer. So he was at least 21.
Right.
But it's like, this guy's fucking tall. I mean, like I was like texting Bert, who booked the show. Like, this motherfucker got tall. Like, right. What the fuck happened? Like I've never seen someone get like a huge growth spurt in like their early 20s.
Maybe he pulled the Tom Cruise and had lifts in his shoes. Who knows?
No. I mean, like he was like lanky.
Oh, substantially taller.
Yeah,
not
like,
just
like, okay. Yeah. And I was like telling my girlfriend, like, he was like short.
Oh.
He was like Cole from the Black Lips kind of tall.
Okay.
How I remembered him. And I was like, I'm like looking up at this guy. And, yeah. But it was a good show. Good turnout. Great set list. Pretty much played like every song of theirs I wanted to hear. You know, crowd was into it, and I got some great photos. Yes, they're up on the site, amusicphotographer.com.
Definitely check that out, because the write-up is really... I said this on Twitter, and I want to... I'm being 100% sincere. I really enjoyed that write-up from someone who used to read a lot of music magazines. That is the kind of shit I'm looking for when someone's writing about music.
Thank you. It's amazing. It's amazing what spite will get you in this life.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, yes.
Yeah, and then a couple nights later, I went to photograph Covet at Del Mar Hall.
Oh, yeah.
Which was, that show was going on at the same time as 100 Gex, which is literally next door.
Yeah,
yeah,
pageant. I was
going to
say.
Still a little sour that I didn't get a faux pass for that. And I kind of had some exchanges with their publicist about it. And I kind of, you know, not to poo-poo Covet, because if I had gotten the 100 Gex faux pass, I would also have tried to
You've done both.
I think more that, like, I knew Covet would be fun, and it fucking was. It was a great set.
Yeah, I've heard nothing but good things about
him. But the thing was, you know, this is before I go back talking to the show, like, I kind of knew who was going to be shooting that 100 Gex show.
Mm.
And I saw, I've only seen one set of photos from it, and I'm just like, so those are your photos. Which is, you know, I'm not trying to be a shit talker, but it's like you.
Yes, you are. Come on, don't hide from it. Just be who you are. No,
but it's like if you're like shooting a sold out show, it's the band's hometown. Like I would bring my fucking A game.
Oh yeah,
and you know there was a big storm Saturday night, so I didn't get out to Del Mar Hall until like right before Covet went on. I mean, like I got like my camera strap, my camera's on me. And, like, I took one photo of Yvette's pedal board because she has this huge pedal board. And there's a sticker on the back of it facing outward towards the crowd that says, don't ask me about my pedal board. I took,
perfect.
I took a photo of that. And they came out on stage. And I didn't even have time to check my settings. I'm just like, I'm just going to fucking freeball it. Yeah, their tour photographer came out and got right into the golden pocket for the first song,
course.
Which had the best light.
Of
and I'm
course.
Like, having the shoe over his shoulder. And I'm like, motherfucker. But he's the one getting paid, so whatever. But I got some really great photos. I wish I could say that they're up on the website right now with a nice little write-up. But I had kind of a crazy week.
By the time the show actually comes out, you might.
Hopefully. Yeah. First night I had opened, I was going to do editing. I had a fucking miserable headache because I work with an ignoramus. And last night, my computer decided it didn't want to boot up anymore. So I think the power supply is the culprit, and I ordered a new one.
I'm doing the sign of the cross.
Hopefully I can get a warranty exchange on, so I have a backup power supply, which really I should have been doing anyways. This is an old build.
Here's hoping.
But I got great foes. It was a great show. Yvette Young is like a guitar polymath almost.
Yeah, kind of like Melissa Paternoster from Screaming Females.
Kind of, yeah. A different type of style. Yvette's more post-rock, kind of math-rocky, like more tapping.
Okay.
The young woman from Screaming Females is just kind of like more like just heavy guitar stuff. Like,
right.
Like someone, it feels like someone that listened to like a lot of like late 70s, early 80s, like hard rock.
Yeah.
And just like a different type of disciple of the guitar.
But still skilled player.
Yeah, and what I like about Yvette is that it's like everything I hated about Guitar Center when I worked there.
Hmm.
Like what I would hear on a Saturday,
but it's like all taken into songs that are like expressive and thoughtful and like very complicated tapping and chords, but it's like it serves a purpose. It's not it's not wanking.
Yeah, yeah.
And like the same thing with like what the bass player is doing, what the drummer is doing, is it like I've seen so many fucking short order cooks fucking do this shit and to know nothing other than masturbatory. It's not a song.
Yeah, Bella Fleck.
Playing blast beats until his girlfriend picks him up. You know, like
right.
But like it's all this really beautiful, coherent thing. And like I was at the back of the room by the merch booth, thinking like, wow, they're probably gonna play for like another half hour. And they're like, yeah, it's our last song, like Love Spell. And I'm like, wait, I thought you guys were just gonna play like they played like their new record, basically front to back. I think they put a couple of classics in there for the, you know, for the old heads. I thought like, oh, like maybe they're gonna take a break.
Right.
No, that was it.
House lights went up.
I don't think there was an encore. I was fucking tired. I wasn't gonna stick around for it. I was like, oh, and I looked at my watch. I'm like, well, they played like almost exactly an hour. I was like, well, you know what? Like that was actually a really fucking solid hour. If it was so enjoyable that I'm like, wait a second.
Right. You want more. Well, yeah. Yeah.
So I'm like, oh, I'm being left hungry, but in the way that's good, and that's fine. So I'm leaving Del Mar Hall, and 100 Gex is getting out at the exact same time, and as I posted on Facebook, there were so many emaciated, like white blonde people that looked like they were the butler from Rocky Horror Picture Show. It was such a weird thing. It was also just weird to see people that are like, you know, 10, 15 years younger than me in the year of our Lord 2023 dressed like how me and my shithead little friends would dress when we would go be mall rats at Crestwood Mall and like literally 20 years ago, like 2003, like I was like one of those things where I see someone wearing bondage pants, I'm going to fucking gouge my eyes out.
Yeah.
But it was just like so weird being like, yeah, I knew someone who dressed like that in high school, or like, oh, yeah, I had an outfit like that.
And it's coming back around every 20 years.
It's fucking weird. Yeah. It was really unsettling. And then being like, I bet they have better taste in music than me and my friends had. Probably. Maybe. Well, I mean, like I think 100 Gex is just like the Zoomer version of Mindless Self-Indulgence.
Yeah, and a little bit of Sleigh Bells in there too. Yeah, a
little bit. But I think they don't say the N-word.
That's true. Yeah, that is definitely a step up.
But I think it's kind of like the trying really hard not to care.
Yeah, and being abrasive on purpose and a lot of that kind of Death Grips shit where it's like...
Yeah, but I think like the new record's fine. I think it's good.
It's good. I liked it.
Fine. I mean, I listened to it once. And I was like, oh, well, I mean, it's like it's the same way how I feel about a Mindless Self-Indulgence record. Listen to it one time.
And you go, yep, oh, I'm good.
Yep, that exists. There were some things I liked, some things I didn't like. But I think 100 Gex, it's a much better endeavor than that. You know, good for them. They sold out their hometown show.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
Covet still had a very, very healthy show up. I mean, it was probably like 600 people, I want to say.
Which is nice. Yeah.
It's very nice. Great. So that was the weekend. Girlfriend and I are still catching up on Succession.
Mm.
We're getting into the back half of season 3.
Okay.
And wow, just what terrible people. Amazing bullshit. And watching Kendall unable to understand the limits of his abilities and unable to actually like ever do anything right.
Yeah.
The birthday party episode is a fucking sledgehammer.
From what little I have seen of it, again, I'm not quite as far as you are, but just like these people are all terrible, but in their own special way.
Yeah. And like sometimes you like want to root for them and then they do something. You go, well, never mind.
Yeah. Well, my weekend involved putting in a new toilet. So that was an exciting toilet. A new toilet.
You put in one of the Asian toilets with the...
No,
seat warmer.
I had it on my list of things, but you know, sadly, the Home Depot by me did not have it. So
did not have the Ogashi.
Nope.
Sumitomo, ass
blaster 3000. Yeah, no.
The Oss Lover.
Sadly, no. They also did not have the bidet kit that I had hoped for. Yeah. But
that translates to the sound of water on your anus.
Yes,
is the rough translation of the toilet's name.
Other than that, we installed the toilet and then got all cleaned up, and then we went to see the Mario movie.
Yeah.
I quite enjoyed the Mario Brothers movie. I was very skeptical from day one. I thought, okay, this is going to be yada, yada. You know, I had a lot of misgivings going into it, most of them dealing with Chris Pratt, but you know.
You know what? He could be in the Daniel Pearl video. For real.
Which we still have not gotten, by the way. 48minutesofdogsbarking@gmail.com. If you
want to send us the yakety sacks. Oh, his head's coming back. Oh,
yep, there it goes. But Mario Brothers movie, far more enjoyable than the Daniel Pearl video. Gotta give it to that.
such a high bar. A
high bar to clear. But yeah, we talked about it last week. And yes, the 80s hits were a little odd, kind of out of place. A-ha's Take on Me doesn't belong in any movie, period, after 1993. But, you know, just I Need a Hero by Bonnie Tyler. Like, you could almost, like, see them coming. You know what I mean? And like we said, when we were just purely speculating on the movie, Koji Kondo writes bangers. And thankfully, in the background of the film, lovingly rendered in full orchestra, there were some great Koji Kondo songs.
Yes, I believe there was a guy with
orchestral
background that did some arrangements.
Some great arrangements. I really enjoyed that part of the film. Even Seth Rogen didn't bother me, which I expected that to be a stick. Yeah, he does it once. And I'm like, okay.
I'm Donkey Kong.
I'll give you one.
I'm smoking weed.
Right. They even briefly hint at the DK rap. They don't do the whole DK rap, but they have it. It's in there. The beat's in there. Every frame is stuffed with references to old Mario stuff. And there's a bit where he's having a crisis of confidence in the background. There's a Jumpman arcade machine. Mm-hmm. I mean, just there's stuff all around that kind of calls back to or harkens back. It's a huge love letter to Nintendo. The whole film is. I enjoyed it for that. But I also just enjoyed it because, like, that was kind of fun.
Oh,
it was fun.
Interesting. Because I heard it was a soulless movie that obviously got shat through, like, 18 rewrites.
There was that, but also at the same time, at the end, it was still enjoyable. Okay. So, I mean,
I'm gonna give it a shot at some point.
Yeah. And then that same night, we came home, made dinner, and then we put on, I said, you know, okay, kids, I watched a movie you wanted to watch. Now you're going to watch one that I want to watch. And I put on, for my 13-year-olds, Inception. Now, the reviews were mixed. My son liked it. My daughter did not.
Yeah.
Now, part of it was because she's, you know, a teen and is easily distracted. And so every once in a while the phone would come out. And, of course, then she'd miss an important scene or whatever. But she goes, well, you know,
the top spinning?
Yeah. Maybe if I was paying more attention, I would have enjoyed it more. I said, well, you know, that's probably true. But, yeah, what an interesting double feature. Mario Bros. Followed by Inception. Every time I watch Inception, there's always something else that I notice or, like, a little detail. I go, oh, that's pretty clever.
You want to know something?
Yes, sir.
I had not seen Inception until, like, last year.
Really? What did you think of Inception?
I thought it was fun. Yeah. I thought it was interesting. It had some really good set pieces.
Mm-hmm.
It was. I remember just being like, oh, yeah, this is really good. I was also glad I didn't watch it when it came out. Because I feel like people were very insufferable. Like, what? Do you think the top still spins? Or, like, maybe his kids are dead? I don't like one of those.
The point of the ending is that he doesn't care anymore. Yeah. He spins the top and he walks away. He's not even looking to see if it doesn't matter. He's with his kids and that's all he cares about. That's the point of the ending, is that it doesn't fucking matter. And I think that's what people missed, is like, yes, you as the audience are watching the top spin and you see it kind of hitch a little bit and then it cuts to black. It's like, yes, because you and I might be thinking about it, but he's not. You know,
very good point.
To me, that's the way the movie is supposed to be read. But again, I'm weird and I like the dumbest fucking movie. So there was that. And then video game wise, I have been searching for the next thing.
Have you played Vampire Survivors yet?
I have. I pick it up every once in a while. It's not something I can sustain for a long time. So I think I'm on level 3 on Vampire Survivors. But, you know, I'm looking for something more narrative-driven. You know, I'm kind of, oh, I want to find a game to, like, finish.
Yeah.
So I started Biomutant. Not great. Just kind of okay. It's a new game studio. They're trying something new. It's a hack and slash, but with guns. It's all right. It's collectibles and whatever. But the one that really wowed me was Sackboy: A Big Adventure. It's a PS5 exclusive one. Now it's on PC. It is a mashup of probably the best stuff about, like, Super Mario 3D World, Rayman Legends, and a few other titles. If you like platformers, it's pretty much the platonic ideal of platformers. It's got a lot of great stuff going on in it. It's cute, it's fun, music's great. can't really be beat. For a while there, it was pretty deeply discounted on the PSN store. I don't know if Xbox has it yet. Pretty sure they don't, because I think it's a first party PlayStation Studios.
Yeah, isn't Sackboy from Little Big Planet?
Sackboy is from Little Big Planet. Yes.
So I think that would rule out Xbox.
But PC owners, I believe it is on PC now. And then I was playing as well with the kids the Jackbox Party Pack.
Oh yeah, no, we've Jackbox.
What a fun game!
I'm sure you see me posting some of my Jackbox.
Great stuff. What it is, for those of you who are not familiar with it, is a series of party games presented by the people who did the old PC game You Don't Know Jack.
Yeah.
And so there's trivia games, and there's ones where you
Murder Trivia Party.
Murder Trivia Party is a jam. I love that one. But there's Quiplash, which is one of my favorites, which is very much a apples-to-apples kind of deal, where you know, they give you a prompt, and then you type in your answer, and then you vote on whose answers are. But it's real fun. You don't have to have anything but, you know, one console and four cell phones, and you have four or however many people are playing.
Yeah,
amount of cell phones. It's a great party.
Oh yeah,
game.
No, with my friends, it's been a mainstay for years.
Well, this is new to us, so we're really jazzed to find out about it. It was something like, oh we can do this, and it quickly became a favorite. I think we're going to do it after our movie night tomorrow. So our movie night tomorrow, by the way, will be Ant-Man: Quantumania. So look forward to hearing my review of that next week on the show.
Glad I'm not you.
Yeah.
With your, like, loving family and the house you own.
Yeah.
At least I don't have to watch Ant-Man.
Right.
I'm going to eat rice and beans and disappoint my girlfriend.
That's all right. I'm going to eat pizza and disappoint my wife. So
it works out. Hey, Manly. Hey, at least you've got pizza.
That about does it for the program, man. Tyler, the Creator, new album is called The Estate Sale. I really enjoyed it. A lot of fun beats. And the one song, Dogtooth, is a hoot. I keep in my head repeating the line. I pull up in the, what the fuck is that, dog? So just on repeat in my head. Go listen to it if you haven't. But yeah, we're gonna close the show up. Brian, where can they find you online?
If you want to hunt me down and tell me the like the old days, you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at ishotgydbord. That's ishotgydbord. So if you want to check out my photography portfolio, it's assholemusicphotographer.com. And if you want to check out some words I've written about foes and things I've photographed, you can check out amusicphotographer.com. WNBC. Amusicphotographer.com.
Highly recommended, by the way. I really enjoyed that.
Really appreciate it.
Definitely up there for me. You can find me on the web there at Video Crime. Most places that there is an option to look for a video crime, that's going to be me, except for Instagram and TikTok. There, I am at Laser Goose CEO. You can get in touch with the show in various ways. My most favorite of which, of course, is our phone number, 314-AHOY. Poo. That's 314-246-9766. Shoot us a text, leave us a voicemail. If you get lucky, I might actually answer the phone, so who knows?
Well, you've got like a work from home desk job.
I do.
So.
I do. You can also shoot us an email, jason@48minutesofdogsbarking.com, brian@48minutesofdogsbarking.com. You can support the show, patreon.com/48minutesofdogs. We're also 48 Minutes of Dogs on Twitter and TikTok as well.
Lovely. You know, I have yet to check my my email there, brian@48minutesofdogs. Is it dogs or dogs barking?
48minutesofdogsbarking.com.
Yeah. 48minutesofdogsbarking.com. You know what? If someone could really make something special for me, whenever I figure out how to fucking check it, I would really love to see as many copies of Goatsy in my inbox. So, if we could get to work on that, it would really warm my heart.
We will do our best. And if you can't financially support the show via Patreon, of course, we always welcome reviews, kind words on social media, whatever you have to give us, we would be really happy to help you there. We're going to leave with a little bit of something. I was listening and thinking about one of our stories that we covered really early in the show, Murphy the Eagle. Of course, that made me think of the Eagles.
You are not the father!
Yes.
Yes.
But it also made me think of the Eagles of Death Metal, one of my favorite bands.
Oh, yeah.
And the song, Don't Speak, I Came to Make a Bang.
Oh,
yeah.
That's a good one.
This in honor of our 40th episode, and here's to 40 and then some many more. 40 episodes of the show, Brian. Well,
wow. We almost have more episodes of the show than we do followers on Twitter.
Fair.
It's fair. Really, really working hard here.
Well, as we always say at this time, namaste and good luck.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Don't be